Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king.
Thank you. took me a while, but I'm finally here. So I just wanna testify, make it crystal clear. See, I've been picked out to be picked on, talked about out my friend's mouth. I've been beat down till he turned my life around.
Turn my life around.
Seems like I always fall short of being worthy, 'cause I ain't good enough, but he still loves me. I ain't no superstar, the spotlight ain't shining on me.
No.
'Cause I ain't good enough, but he still loves me.
Loves me.
I used to
wake up some days and wish I'd have stayed asleep, 'cause I went to bed on top of the world. Today the world's on top of me. Everybody's got opinions.
They should.
They've been in my position.
Gotta raise my heart when I hear what they have to say about me.
What they say about me.
Seems like I always fall short of being worthy, 'cause I ain't good enough, but he still loves me. I ain't no superstar. Spotlight been shining. But he still loves me. I'm not perfect. Yes, I do wrong.
Yes, I do.
I'm trying my best, but it ain't good enough.
Shun by the word.
Shun by the word.
If I don't succeed, 'cause I ain't good, but he still loves me. If you ain't worthy, just raise your hands and let me know that you understand.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Mr. Lafayette Harris, our music director for the Prelude. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. I pray that you will consecrate yourself to Jesus now. Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, the Son of the living God, as we come together to worship him. I'm Reverend Clark Bradley, pastor of Fourth Presbyterian Church here in the Bronx, and this is our streaming worship service for today, March 21st, 2021. So we are now officially 1 year into lockdown. It was a year ago this week that we started our lockdown, and we're still in it. So welcome to all of you who are watching the live streaming service. Those of you are our friends and members, welcome to you on Facebook and YouTube. And also special welcome to our visitors, especially first-time visitors. Welcome, thank you for joining us today to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Before we officially start our worship service, I want to bring up our order of worship, especially for any visitors we might have that aren't familiar with it. We've got our call to worship from Hebrews chapter 10. And you see the item up there at the sort of the top of the list, Prelude. That's what Lafayette just played. Now we're at the greetings, and we're about to move to the call to worship. Before we do, I just wanted to remind you that you can get all the graphics that we're using that have words like here, the order of worship, the call to worship, the scripture readings, the prayers, the words to the songs, the hymns that we'll sing. You can get all of those graphics on the church's Facebook page in a post that will be separate from the live streaming service. So it's not on that post, it's on a separate post. And also, if you received an email with the links to today's service, the graphics should be attached to that as well. So let's move on now and start our service with today's call to worship. Comes from Hebrews chapter 10. We have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is, his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Let us worship God and let us pray. Heavenly Father, I do pray for your presence with us now. I pray that by your Spirit that you would cleanse our hearts, that you would, by your Spirit, wash our bodies so that we are prepared to enter your presence and join with all the angels and the saints who've gone before us, praising you, singing a hallelujah to our Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. The prayer of confession is next, and Elder Donald is here to lead us. This will be Donald's last Sunday with us as worship assistant, at least for the near-term future. He's been, what has it been, Donald, 5 Sundays?
5 weeks, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So what are you going to do with all your free time on Saturday when we're recording? I hear you've got a project outside of work, actually.
Yes, it's a book I'm writing, an exam prep book for Cisco. So that's taken up most of my time on weekends. So I'll be working on that for the next couple months or so.
Yeah, so that's for computer networks for people. Right.
So it's for this Cisco networks. It's basically an exam cram guide.
Yeah, so it's a certification guide. So they got you to write the book on it. Okay. All right, Donald. Great. Let me bring up the prayer of confession. Here it is. So Donald, why don't you lead us in prayer?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you created and bought us with a price. We should joyfully obey and trust you, but we don't. We treat ourselves as kings instead of you. We satisfy our desires, not your will. We have trusted this world's promises and found insecurity, anxiety, and fear. Lord, we confess that we have grown a crop of sin, secret and open, half conscious and deliberate, in attitude and in action. Have mercy on our souls. Plant your grace so deep within us that we become a garden of holiness and joy to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You are the Lord, giver of mercy. You are the Christ, giver of mercy. You are the Lord, you are the Lord. You are the Lord, giver of mercy. You are the Lord, giver of mercy. You are the Christ, giver of mercy.
Words of assurance. Who is in a position to condemn? There is only one in that position, and that one is named Jesus. So listen now to what that same Jesus has already done for us. Jesus has died for us. Jesus has risen for us. Jesus has ascended into heaven where he continually prays for us. So whoever is in Christ is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. Friends, believe the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And that all God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we'll continue now with the passing of the peace. So peace be with you, Lafayette.
Peace be with you.
Yeah, and peace be with all of you who are out there watching. Those of you who are with somebody can pass the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ to whoever's with you. And if you're on the Facebook or YouTube chat, you can greet each other with the peace of the Lord there as well. And while you're doing that, I'd ask you to, if you have children with you, I'd ask you to have them come forward at this time so that they can receive the children's, they can receive Jesus's blessing. So if the children can come forward to this, towards the screen and stretch out their hands, I'd ask you to have them do that if you have children with you. Heavenly Father, I lift up to you all the children who are viewing this service now, and I pray for you to bless them. I ask, Lord, that you would bless them by calling them to your into your eternal kingdom, that you would open their hearts and their minds to receive your Son by faith, and that you would call them to eternal life with yourself in heaven. I pray, Lord, also that you would surround them with your mighty angels, that you would guard and protect them from harm and evil in the week ahead. May they, Lord, I pray for their schools. May their minds be open and ready to learn. May they be able to focus on the lessons of their teachers. And I pray, Lord, that you would give encouragement to their teachers, that they would be encouraged to teach the material that they're to cover, that you would give them creativity and insight to teach in this strange and difficult era of teaching that we are currently in. So I pray for our students, your blessing on them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's continue now. We move on to the announcements. That's the next item in our order of worship. you can see there the under today, we've got the information about our streaming service. So that's, if you're watching this, you obviously know. Let's move on to prayer requests. Our prayer requests is the next item on the order of worship. And if you want to submit a prayer for us to pray during this time, send it to fourthpcbronx@gmail.com. with the word prayer in the subject line, and please send it by Friday morning or Friday evening or Saturday morning at the latest, so we have time to review them. Also, you see there our Children's Online Sunday School. So if you have a child that you want to have in that, please contact the church at the same email, fourthpcbronx@gmail, and we'll get you in touch with Acusia, who's the Sunday school teacher this semester. Another announcement, I received a link this is for vaccines for people who are homebound. So if you have a friend or family member who is really homebound and just can't get out, New York City is offering home vaccines. It's the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. Because if you remember, that's the one that doesn't have any unusual temperature requirements. So I guess they can count on that to keep for the whole day as the nurses travel around administering vaccines. So you can go to that link that you see there, and gives you a form. The link is a form that you fill out requesting for somebody a home vaccine. So just want you to be aware of that. And also regarding vaccines, I'd heard that if you're anywhere near the church, the Rite Aid, it's on Tremont Avenue, right near Westchester Square. So it's at where Tremont Avenue and Williams Bridge are sort of the same street for a very short period of time. At the beginning of Williams Bridge, it and Tremont are sort of the same street. So right there at that point, there's a Rite Aid, and apparently I've heard that they have a lot of vaccines. It's the Pfizer vaccine. So if you're interested, you can call there or go there and see if you can get the vaccine from them. So that's here in the neighborhood of the church over by Westchester Square, the Rite Aid it's on Tremont Avenue. So that is under upcoming events. Next week is Palm Sunday, so that's the beginning of Holy Week. And we have we will be streaming. You see there for Palm Sunday, it's the beginning of Holy Week. We'll have our streaming service. And Good Friday is at noon. That's our traditional time for our Good Friday service. And as you can see from the note there, we're going to work on making this a live stream. So I've talked with Lafayette about it, and we think we can pull this off. So hopefully it'll work, and we will have a live stream on Good Friday at noon. So we'll send out links to that. That would just be on the Facebook. Lafayette, let me stop sharing here for just a second. Lafayette, have you done live streams on YouTube?
I sure have.
I thought you had. I thought I remembered that you have. Do you have to send out a link to people, or do they just go to your YouTube homepage and it's there?
I send a link.
Yeah, so for the live stream itself. So on Facebook, we wouldn't need to send a live stream. If you just go to the church Facebook page, which when I go back, you can see it at the top of the announcements there. I'll flip back to that in just a minute, and you'll see the live stream there on Facebook, but on YouTube. So we'll have to send out a link, probably something like 11:45 or 11:50 on Good Friday morning. If we're going to practice before to make sure we can actually pull this off. So that's how we'll do that on Good Friday. So let me bring the announcements. Let me go back to sharing mode here. So then you see Easter Sunday, that will be a normal service that is recorded like this one. So those are the main announcements. I should have asked while you were on the screen there, Lafayette, do you have anything to add?
Well, I just want to say happy spring to everybody. My first Sunday of spring.
Yeah.
And also to remind you all that in continuance of Women's History Month, I'm doing another live streaming this Thursday from my Facebook page and also from my YouTube channel. And it is, we're featuring the wonderful Miss Cecilia Smith, vibraphonist, on some of her compositions and mini jazz standards. So that's 7 o'clock, the 25th, Thursday night.
Okay, 7 p.m. on Thursday. Okay. Mm-hmm. And you're going to send out a link to the people in the church, or?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, great.
And they can access it easily by going to my Facebook page, Lafayette Harris Jr. Piano.
Okay, great. So those are the announcements for today. Let's continue moving forward with our prayers today. We have a number of prayers. We've had several people, not direct members of the congregation, but we've had several people pass away in the last week, and some other people have been sickened by the virus. So the virus is definitely hanging around. Let's be together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do come to you today, thankful for the gifts that you have given us. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of life on this day. And Lord, we lift up to you those who mourn people who've passed in the last week. Especially, we lift up to you those who are mourning Nada and Claudius. Lord, we pray especially for Reuben and for John as they mourn their dear family members who've passed on. And we ask, Lord, for you to bless everyone who mourns Nada and Claudius. Bless them with the comfort of your spirit. May this difficult time draw them closer to Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. We do praise you, Jesus, that you do give us such strong hope in seeing our loved ones again. When in the resurrection, that death is not the end. So I pray, Lord, for your blessing upon all who mourn, those who've passed in the last week, and especially Nada and Claudius. Lord, we do lift up to you those who are struggling with difficult physical conditions. We pray for Acusia Dumphy and her vision. We pray for Kusia Abrokwa and her condition, and we lift up to you Trevor and his heart condition. Lord, we pray that you would bless them with strength, that you would empower their bodies, that you would bless them with the strength of body and strength of spirit as they struggle with these difficult conditions. Lord, we also lift up to you those who are recovering from surgery. We pray for Courtney. We pray also that you would bless Gwadi with physical strength. We lift up to you, Lord, people who are seeking the COVID-19 vaccine and those who are administering it, that you would enable them to accomplish their goals. So we pray, Lord, for our people in healthcare, who the many people in this congregation who serve others in the healthcare field, and pray, Lord, for you to protect their health and to give them strength and give them compassion for the sick whom they care for in the week ahead. Lord, we pray that you would bless your churches. We lift up to you especially Trinity Church and Hocknesia Church, and pray, Lord, for your gift of peace, the blessing of your Spirit's presence that they would know that your Spirit is with them, and give them strength as congregations, and give them wisdom for the difficult futures they face. Lord, we pray for our neighbors here in the area around the church. We lift up to you, Lord, all those who are not, who do not know Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, for their salvation. We ask for you to bless them with that you would visit them, that you would open the eyes of their hearts, the ears of their minds, they would hear and see the truth about your Son Jesus and come to faith in him. We pray for your church around the world as we approach Holy Week now. We pray that you would protect your church where it is vulnerable, that you would thwart the plans of people to disrupt services and attack your people and their churches around the world. We pray especially for your people in Africa, in the Middle East, in South Asia, and East Asia. Lord, we do pray that you would bless them with mighty faith that is stronger than the powers of evil that come against them. And we ask, Lord, for your blessing on them as they worship you, that they would experience your presence in worship, especially during Holy Week, that they would know that you are with them even in a place of persecution. So, Lord, we lift these prayers up to you in the name of our Savior Jesus, who taught us to pray our Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. We're ready to move on to our first hymn today. Our first hymn for today. It comes from the old worship book. I hope you still remember what that is. Those of you who've been in the, you know, have attended church in the sanctuary, the old worship book number 628, we sing the mighty power of God. The words will come up on the screen in a moment, and I invite you to join our choir in singing, We Sing the Mighty Power of God.
We sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad, and built the lofty skies. We sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command,
come now to our time to read from God's word. But before we do, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do pray that you will open our hearts and minds this day to receive your truth, to receive the gift of faith through your word. Amen. We bring up our Old Testament reading here. We're going to read, it's going to be on two pages. It's from Genesis chapter 22, one of the most important and also one of the most frightening passages in the entire Bible. Let's read from Genesis chapter 22, the first 19 verses. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went along, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up, and there in a thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And on this day it is said, and to this day it is said, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and your offspring, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me." Then Abraham returned to his servants, and they set off together for Beersheba, and Abraham stayed in Beersheba. There ends our Old Testament reading. We'll continue on now with our gospel reading from Mark chapter 14. This is Mark's account of Jesus in Gethsemane. Mark 14, verses 32 to 42. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now for our anthem today, it will be the anthem Heaven.
Where I want to be.
Friends, please pray with me. Heavenly Father, may we receive your word, your promise today. Amen. This is a test of God's spiritual emergency system. Well, that's a paraphrase, I guess you'd say, a paraphrase of Genesis chapter 22, verse 1. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. The chapter opens with a clear, straightforward statement. The correct way to understand what follows is as a test that God administers to Abraham. One question needs to be dealt with before moving on. Was Isaac ever in danger? Answer, Isaac's life was never in danger. Abraham had two choices in responding to God. He could say, no, I won't do it. Such a response would mean that the threat to Isaac's life was gone. Or two, Abraham could say, yes, I will obey. And in this case, God stops Abraham at the last second. So in neither case was Isaac's life actually threatened. The text focuses our attention in its first verse. This is a story of God testing Abraham, not God threatening Isaac. The intent, the purpose of God's command is not to kill a child, but to kill an idol. Treating children, especially an only child like Isaac, as an idol, a substitute for God, is a threat to the spirituality of parents in every culture across all generations. Children are wonderful blessings from God, but they are not substitutes for God. God tests Abraham to discover if Abraham's devotion to God exceeds his devotion to the idol child. Did Abraham's love for Isaac, did it blind him? Did he forget where Isaac came from? This test exposes the danger of taking God's gifts and loving them, loving those gifts more than we love God. It reveals how deep the great commandment goes. Love God above all else, even family. Learn to love God supremely, not to love God's good gifts. And friends, it's exactly because God gives good and perfect gifts, because his gifts are so good. It's because of the goodness of the gifts that even mature believers are tempted to love them rather than God. Supreme worship and adoration belong to God alone and not to any of the gifts he gives us. It is right for God to demand ultimate allegiance to himself above all created things. The content of the test, the test of love, is made plain by God's description of Isaac. Your only son whom you love. In Genesis chapter 22, God tests Abraham to discover if he will still follow God, even after Abraham received the promised gift of God. Once Abraham got everything he wants from God, will Abraham turn away from the blessor and worship the blessing? Will he turn away from the giver and worship the gift? Will Abraham hold on to his dream of a son, or will he let go of his lifelong dream and hold on to faith in God, rather than holding on to the dreams of this world? In order to pass this test, Abraham must deny the transactional spirituality he learned growing up in Ur, the mode of spirituality where I seek benefits from the pagan gods at minimum cost to me. Instead, Abraham must learn to live for God, not for himself, in a relationship that considers no cost too great to offer God, no price too high to pay. In this way, Genesis chapter 22 reveals, or Genesis chapter 22 represents the final and ultimate test of Abraham's faith. For weeks now, I've referred to this idea of transactional spirituality. Today, I want to play a video clip that demonstrates this pagan spirituality. The clip comes from a movie that we used during Bible study a few years ago, named Risen. In this scene, the main character, Clavius, he's a Roman military commander, has been tasked by the governor, Pontius Pilate, with the hopeless job of finding the corpse of the risen Jesus. So it is hopeless. Clavius prays for divine help, divine aid in finding Jesus' disciples, and he thinks through them Jesus' body. I'll play the clip now. In case you missed it, I'll repeat Clavius' prayer. Here's the prayer he said. I pray not to thee today, divine Mars. Mars would have been the Roman god of war, so of course a warrior, a military commander, prays to Mars usually. I pray not to thee today, divine Mars, but to the God of the Hebrews, Yahweh. Hear me. Take back your favor and defense of these people I seek and relinquish them to me. If you do this with clear and recognizable signs, I vow to erect temples for you and initiate games in your honor. I hope you recognize the transactional spirituality involved in this prayer. Clavius knows he needs help from beyond this world. So he offers to make a deal, a transaction. You give me what I want, these people, that is Jesus's disciples, and I will give you what you want, temples for worship on your, for your worship and honor. And to seal the deal, Clavius drops down a payment in coins, with a loud clink at the end of that clip. It's a perfect example of ancient pagan spirituality, just what Abraham grew up with in Ur. God has worked with Abraham for 35 to 40 years, developing a relationship with Abraham based not on mutual advantage, on transactions that bring mutual advantage, but on mutual love. Now God asks, did it work? Is Abraham's soul changed? He has the precious gift he longed for. Is the transaction over now? Is he done with God, or will Abraham remain faithful? Another way of understanding the test is to ask, what does Abraham consider most precious, of supreme value? Isaac is Abraham's beloved son. Did Abraham possess anything more valuable than Isaac? The test proves that Abraham's relationship with God ranked higher than his love for Isaac. Abraham would rather keep his relationship with Yahweh than keep God's gift, the promised son. What a terrible test. God asks Abraham to sacrifice his most valuable possession, to sacrifice his future. That's what Isaac is. God's test revealed what Abraham considered the ultimate good, the one thing which can never be sacrificed for something better, because nothing is better. The promise of descendants was the foundation of this relationship. And in that promise, God tapped into Abraham's deepest desire with his promise of a son. Now Abraham is asked to voluntarily surrender his greatest worldly good, his one beloved son. The test in Genesis chapter 22 answers the question, was God just a transaction for Abraham, or was God the supreme object of Abraham's life? What could be Abraham's reason for submitting to this demand, the demand of God? It had to be that he saw a greater good, a good more valuable than anything on earth. In order to maintain this greatest possible good, Abraham sacrificed his greatest worldly good, demonstrating that Abraham had learned this spiritual truth: nothing is better than the goodness of God. That knowledge drove Abraham to obey God's terrible command, because if the supreme goodness said this was necessary, well, then somehow it must be necessary. God's test resulted not in God's own knowledge. God knows everything. Rather, the test revealed to the world the meaning of true faith. In Genesis chapter 22, people witness an example of true faith in God. God uses tests not to discover for himself how much faith we have, but to teach us, to prove to us the level of our faith. Through testing, God enables us to know something about ourselves that we didn't and we couldn't know before. Excuse me. Also, through testing, potential faith becomes actual. God had no need to discover something he didn't know. What God needed to do through this test was release into the world the faith that was already in Abraham, but potential. The depth of Abraham's faith became actual when it was released by this greatest of tests. Okay, let's review what we've learned so far from Genesis chapter 22. One, this ultimate test was a spiritual challenge for Abraham. It never actually threatened Isaac's life. Two, the purpose or intent of the test was not to kill a child, but to kill an idol. Loving anything of this earth over and above God, above loving God. And third, the test revealed true godly spirituality in contrast to the transactional spirituality that Abraham had grown up with. Fourth, the result of the test was to convert potential faith into actual faith. So we can understand why God designed such a terrible test for Abraham. It makes sense at this initial stage of God's plan for salvation history, that line which will ultimately produce God's Messiah, the Savior who will bless all the peoples of the earth, well, it must start with a titanic act of faith and trust in God. Yet even while understanding this, still, does your heart ache at the horror of the test? Okay, I comprehend why. Still, did it need to be so awful, such a punishing test? Is God cruel? Why does God demand so much from us? Friends, if you wonder, you should know that you are not alone. Let me quote to you another passage from the Bible that asks God directly, is there any other way? Do we have to do this? Here's that verse. Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Yes, God tested Abraham to the extreme of human capacity to be tested. I don't believe anyone in the Bible suffers a more severe test. No one but Jesus. Today's concluding point reminds you of something I've said many times. Never in the Bible does God ask us to do something he isn't willing to do himself. Yes, asking Abraham to sacrifice his son, his only son whom he loved, it was a punishing test. Yet in the end, God did not require Abraham to actually do it. God didn't require Abraham to go through with the test. The knife that Abraham raised, you could say that spiritually speaking, it was left hanging there in the air when the angel said, "Do not lay a hand on the boy. Don't do anything to him." That raised knife stayed there, hanging there. It did not descend until Calvary, when it descended upon another beloved only son. Jesus said what Abraham did not. "Not my will, but your will be done." Abraham rose and returned to his servants, set off for home in Beersheba, his son alive. Jesus said, "The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." And Jesus went to the cross to die for us. Abraham's act of faith releases potential faith into the world as actual faith. But Jesus's act of faith on the cross released perfect faith into the world, releasing God's mercy to save us all. The ancient church knew that Abraham's near sacrifice of Isaac foreshadowed the actual sacrifice of the cross. As the angel said to Abraham, "Because you have obeyed me, through your offspring all nations will be blessed." Well, that promise became true when the offspring of Abraham obeyed his heavenly father's will, which feels even more cruel. Yes, the test of Abraham was awful, but through it, God pointed to the ultimate fulfillment of God's promise when an only son did die as a sacrifice for the world. Christians have from the earliest times understood Isaac as a prefiguring of Christ, the beloved son offered as the sacrifice for the people's sin. Very early in Christian history, the story of Abraham's offering of Isaac becomes the counterpart of God's. It was the Old Testament counterpart of God's sacrifice of his only son on Calvary in the New Testament. That greatest of all sacrifices produced the greatest of all goods, forgiveness for all our sins and eternal life for all who believe. I pray you will live by faith, trusting in God, in the God who loves you beyond all measure. Even through the worst trials and tests of this life, trust in God. Praise be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do praise you, the giver of every good and perfect gift. Now give us the gift of faith to trust in you and love you beyond all else. Amen. Well, friends, we've come to the time to say what we believe. Elder Donald is back with us, and he is going to lead us in this great ancient creed, the Apostles' Creed. And here it is on the screen. So, Donald, why don't you lead us now?
Let us say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. Our next hymn, our second hymn out of two, so that makes it the last hymn, is Precious Lord. Precious Lord, the words will come up on the screen in a moment. Thank you, choir, for leading us in that hymn. And now we do come to the offering time. I'll bring up our offering information on the screen here. You can see we can receive electronic donations on Zelle at treasurer@4thpc.org. You can also send checks to the church, and you can drop checks off at the church if you come around to the Newbold side. So just put them in an envelope, and you can drop them through the mail slot on the double doors there on the Newbold side by the gate, in front of the gate. So those are the ways that you can donate. We do thank you, those of you who have been generous to us in the past few weeks. We thank you for your gifts. We do pray that you'll continue to support us into this uncertain future that we all face, including the church. So thank you for your gifts. And I'd like to stop sharing now and bring up Lafayette. In just a moment, Lafayette will be leading us in our offertory. So let me bring him up on the screen.
Doxology.
To the end of the service, our last prayer is the prayer of dedication, and Elder Donald will lead us in that. Here it is on the screen. So why don't you lead us, Donald?
Let us pray. We praise you, Heavenly Father, the source of all that we are and all that we have. You bless us with abundant good things, and now we return to you a portion of what you have entrusted to our care. Use our gifts for your glory and for blessing of all your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So Donald is, this is the last prayer for that he'll lead for a while. So take care, Donald. Have a blessed week. And well, I guess you'll be watching instead of participating in the future. So.
All right. Bye, everyone.
Yep. All right. Bye-bye, Donald. Well, friends, we come now to the end of today's service. Thank you for joining us. I pray that you were uplifted by our music, that you were informed, instructed, and drawn close to Jesus by our prayers and our words today. I'd ask you now to receive God's blessing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of God the Holy Spirit be with you, with those you love, and with those nobody loves, this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Goodbye. Lord willing, we'll see you next Sunday, Palm Sunday. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.